When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the tolls of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Let us pray. Father, we give thanks for all the many blessings of life. We thank You, Lord, that we have this chance to return unto You some of what You have given to us. We just ask that You bless it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Six, 466, send a great revival. I'm
gonna sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Oh, 6 months before he died. Jesus said, come and drink. He was the source for anyone who had a thirst. Anyone. Anyone with a spiritual thirst. On this side of the cross, we know that he is the living water. The Bible says the ingredients in that water are peace, purity, truth, and power. The peace that we all desire in our lives. The purity that we all need in our lives. And the power to live our lives for Him. Peace, purity, truth. And power. I think I left out the truth of God's word. The truth of God's word. Peace, purity, truth, and power. Now the Bible says you not only have to come to Jesus, but it says you have to drink. Always remember you can stand waist deep in the Colorado River and still die of thirst. Also, his water cleanses. Jesus' water cleanses. Some of us have gotten dirty. There are days where I feel like I need to spiritually tear away these filthy rags. Stand with arms outstretched and let water pour on me, soak me. I'd like to love the Lord so much, so much, that I'd never again thirst for the muddy waters of sin. I believe that's what it's like with our sin. Filthy water. I want to talk for a few minutes this morning about being thirsty. Have you ever been in that middle of the desert feeling where you're really thirsty? I haven't been that thirsty. But I can tell you that I have been thirsty. Most of us have been. I can't tell you how thirsty I was the first 46 years of my life. And people who are of this world are desperately in 2023 trying to quench their thirst. Lost people. Can't find enough stuff in this world to satisfy their thirst. As a Christian, I get thirsty, but I get thirsty in a different way. I thirst spiritually. Ever done that? I thirst spiritually. I thirst for the Word of God. And we all should. You see, being a Christian isn't about acting a certain way. It's not about all of the good things you do. It's about some of the things you have to do to satisfy yourself. You can thirst because of a sin in 2023, and you can die of that thirst spiritually. You can be walking around dead. That's why you need to read the Bible. That's why you need to read verses, memorize verses. That's why you need to read different books. That's why you need to study. So you don't spiritually die. And that's what we ought to thirst for. We ought to thirst for the Word of God. We ought to thirst to be around other believers. But unfortunately, many Christians don't have that kind of thirst. Therefore, they have lived in a parched land for a long, long time. I've been preaching for quite a while. And I can tell you, preachers get in a dry, parched land sometimes. Some of them, I feel like, are being held there. They're in captivity. They have no other church they can go to. They want to leave, and they can't. And you can see them just dry up spiritually. Churches can dry up spiritually. I believe churches, all of the church, can become dry and thirsty and suffer. Look at verse 38. He says, whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him. In other words, those who are saved, those who believe, those who trust him are filled with the Holy Spirit. And his Holy Spirit is an inexhaustible river of living water. Sometimes we may not go to the river often enough, but it's there for us. And if we allow it to, it wells up in us to power us. And then it flows through us to help change the world around us. I do know this. We have that living water. That living water. It's on tap in our lives. Maybe you don't use it. Maybe you've never used it. But there is living water through the Holy Spirit that's inside of you. I think if we allow it to, it will flow through us and out of us and change the world that's around us every single day. And if that water flows, if that water flows through us every single day, you know what you can overcome? You can overcome the temptation of alcohol, of food, of sex, of work, or any other compulsion. All of us need that living water. That living water. Verse 40. On hearing his words, some of the people said, "Surely this man is a prophet." We look at it from this side of the cross and we say, no joke. But they're on the other side. He was a prophet. He was a prophet. But he was so much more. Some today believe he was nothing more than a great teacher. Amen. He was. Is that all? Some say he was a great preacher. Preach the good news. But is that all? You see, these people were wrong about Jesus. They were wrong. How do you think Jesus felt? In fact, as he asked in the Bible, who do people say that I am? Who do you say he is? Then go down to verse 41. Others said he is the Christ. In other words, they believed he was who he said he was. Who did he say he was? Born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, died for your sins and mine, raised on the third day, sits this morning at the right hand of his Father in heaven. You believe that? Those who believe that with all of their hearts should be able to stand up and say, he is the Christ. He is the Christ. Amen. Are you willing to stand up before anybody, before any group, and testify? He is my Lord. He is the Christ, the Son of God. You say that back then, you may get something thrown at you. Could be rotten fruit. Could be a stone. Could be a knife. It took courage back then. But I challenge you this morning to testify. Testify that He is your Lord. Testify that He's your Savior. Stand up and testify that there's nothing in your life more important than Jesus Christ. Let me just ask you this morning, are you willing to stand up for Him the way He stood up for you? You know what I'm talking about is Christian guts. Look at verses 41 and 42. The Bible says, and still others ask, how can the Christ come from Galilee? Does not the Scripture say that the Christ will come from David's family and from Bethlehem, the town where David lived? Let me tell you something, those people are still waiting on someone today. I'm not sure who, but they're waiting on someone today. But the Messiah, the one they are waiting on, has already come. And when He comes again, it's going to be too late for those people. The one they're waiting on has already been here. And finally, verse 43, it says, the people were divided because of Jesus. The people were divided because of Jesus. Nothing in this world can divide like Jesus. He can divide husbands and wives. He can divide families. He can divide marriages. Jesus Christ can divide. And He's done it since the very beginning. This world is still divided today. It's divided over Jesus Christ and a lot of other stuff. But eventually, that stuff's not going to matter. He divides people. Oh, He really doesn't. He brings people to Him. He brings people together. He'll change a church. He'll change a community. But the world that He looks at is divided. It's divided because some people choose Him. A lot of them don't. That's why we live in a divided world. People are divided in Mills County. Denominations are divided because of Jesus Christ. Families are divided. It's been this way since way back when. Some people choose to follow Jesus and some don't. Why don't they? They and make me so mad. I don't have great eyesight, but I can see it plain as day. You have two choices in life. You can go to heaven or you can go to hell. I found the way to heaven. I try to share it with y'all every Sunday. I know how to get there. But I can't find any instructions on how to drag people along. I want everybody in heaven. I want it so bad that I shed tears. I want everyone to go. I believe Satan is using a lot of things in this world today to try to grab hold of us. And he's got a bunch of them hanging on. But here's what I have to say to you this morning. Jesus Christ loves you. That's it. What about your relationship with him? You see, love has to go both ways. He loves us. What are we doing in return? I know God loves us too. He wants to protect us. And so you have God in heaven, you have Jesus Christ, his Son. You can't have one without the other. Two for one deal. If you accept Jesus Christ, you get God also. And you have to accept Jesus Christ because he's the one that paid the price for us. Sometimes I can see him at train stations saying, come on, Dallas. I've already paid the fare. It's taken care of. Come on, get on board. I don't know whether his dad is the conductor or the engineer or what. My dad worked for the railroad, so I used to travel on train cars a lot. And it would kind of scare you when the conductor would come by and say, take it. Hey, what do you do if you don't have a ticket? What are they going to do, throw you off? Maybe you're right. Or get to the next station and let you go. I'm going to tell you what, if you don't have Jesus Christ getting you into heaven, you ain't going to heaven.
Amen.
Meanwhile, down here, we say, Lord, keep me from lustful thoughts. Lord, protect me from alcohol. Lord, protect me from drugs. There's a second step you have to take. Make good choices. Make good choices. God gave you a brain. Use it. Don't drive at 90 miles an hour. Don't stick a loaded gun in your mouth and pull the trigger. And not expect to die. don't pet a rattlesnake. Fasten your seatbelt. I'm giving advice now. Make good choices. I will admit this, and I'm a living example. Sometimes God protects even those who make really stupid choices. I did. I survived. But don't bet your life on it. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the verses in the book of John. These inspire me. I hope they have inspired others. Lord, thank you for the wonderful people in this church this morning. And I pray if they need to make a decision, you will pour out your Holy Spirit on them. Give them the courage. It's in your holy name I pray. Amen.